So this morning's message, the text will come from Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. And what I want to do is back up and include verse 8, because verse 8 is where we left off in our last study. And that'll help us to get a little bit more of the context here before us. So let's read through that text, and then we'll talk about the exalted position of the one who humbled himself. And we saw that humiliation in our previous study. The one who humbled himself, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Paul writes in Philippians chapter 2, verse 8, verse 7, but made himself of no reputation, and took up on him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. We'll be talking about names here this morning. That at the name of Jesus, what is that name? At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. All right. I want to now read a companion passage. This one sits over in the book of Ephesians, and it's a companion passage of sorts, in that this passage also speaks to the exalted position of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let's take a quick look at this one. Starting in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19, Paul writes, "And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward, who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead, and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet." We read in Philippians how he humbled himself and then he was given this exalted position. "And hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing." Now we're jumping to Colossians for a second. "Being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, God's dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins." Marvelous passage, folks. But let's remember here very quickly. Satan's main strategy in this age of grace is ignorance. Spiritual ignorance, in order to obtain silence. That's how I see it. When it comes to the believers in this dispensation who are supposed to be making an impact by what we say and what we think and what we do on the angelic host in heavenly places. We are not a schoolhouse, in a manner of speaking, to the angelic host in the sense that we're teaching them. But what God is doing in us and what he's done for us, doing in us and through us, is that schoolhouse to the angelic host. So there's an impact being made in heavenly places as we honor the one who's been placed in this exalted position. How do we make that impact? Well, by proclaiming the things that go along with the mystery, as Paul called it, the mystery, the secret that was revealed to and through the apostle of this dispensation, the apostle Paul. As he said that ye might, speaking of us by extension here, walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, as we read, increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness, once again, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet, or appropriate, fitted to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. He's delivered us from the power of darkness, we read, translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. So we're seated. We're seated right now in heavenly places in Christ. At least in a positional sense, in a judicial positional sense. Paul tells us that in Ephesians chapter 6, that positionally speaking, God hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So in that sense, we've already been translated in the mind of God into the kingdom of his dear Son. So let's keep going. This is getting good. In whom, verse 14 continues, we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Redemption and forgiveness are present possessions. This is a major focal point of the mystery when it comes to what God has now revealed, sin no longer being the issue with God. We already have redemption and forgiveness. Not things we need to seek from God, but things God's already accomplished for us. We need simply believe that they're ours in order to appropriate in our own thinking what Christ has already accomplished on our behalf. Our redemption is complete. Our forgiveness is all complete and all up front. Both are past tense accomplishments that Paul would have us acknowledge and proclaim as part of his special mystery message. Who accomplished them for us? Well, none other than our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, verse 15, who is the image of the invisible God. Now, we looked at the morphe. I would get that word morphe in our last study. Who is the image, the very intrinsic nature of God? Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? For by him, by the pre-incarnate Christ, that is, were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be, Paul qualifies them, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him, and you could underline this in your Bible if you'd like, for him. So there's an exalted position now in play when it comes to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God hath highly exalted him, and he humbled himself first. Take special notice of those two little words, for him, there, because this is the issue that we're going to be looking at this morning as we continue in our Philippians text. For whom again? For our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's who. Verse 17, and he, notice it, he who again? The Lord Jesus Christ is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he, the Lord Jesus Christ again, is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the first from the dead, that in all things he, the Lord Jesus Christ again, might have, what's the word? Preeminence. Do you see an exalted position sitting here? And why I've read all these verses? Because all of these passages we've just read, we've just gone over, although they do not sit in the epistle to the saints in Philippi, they have to do with the exalted position of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And here we see that word preeminence, and that is absolutely, it's a supreme position. That's the idea we want to look at here. So is there any question as to who it is that has the right to the title sovereign head of the universe? Because this is a headship issue Paul's taking us to in Philippians. Jesus Christ is unquestionably the rightful Lord of the universe. Satan is not Lord, we know that. Jesus Christ is Lord. Satan is called the prince of the power of the air, the god, little g, of this world. But by proclaiming the very fact that Jesus Christ is, what would be the word again? Lord. He is Lord. We who have trusted in his finished work at Calvary on our behalf are making an impact through our acknowledgement of his rightful position as sovereign head of the universe. We are making that acknowledgement every time we use his title. And so that acknowledgement's being made to those principalities and powers in heavenly places Paul refers to in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10. You see, we not only make that impact through our knowledge of and through our proclamation of the fellowship of the mystery, that's one way we make that impact, we need to understand that a part of that mystery message, a part that we sometimes fail to take as seriously, I think, as we ought to take it, is that Jesus Christ is Lord of the universe. Proclaiming his lordship, his rightful title, the title of his exalted position, is